Good morning. I'm Judy LaPointe, the Executive Director of the Summit Chamber of Commerce, and I'd like to welcome you all here today. It's a pretty cool day. I think we oversold. I know that Breckenridge is sitting at table 16.5, and there might be some other stragglers, so if you have an empty table at an empty seat at your table, please feel free to welcome any guests that you don't know. I wanted to just make a couple of announcements before we get started, and I am so grateful once again to announce that in your goodie bags there is a day lift ticket from Loveland. Yeah. And there is a tubing ticket for two at the Adventure Park. And I'm not kidding you, if you haven't been there, it is so dang much fun. It is just a kick. And so use this, because it really is a fun, fun thing. And then finally, we also have from Summit Express a one-way ticket to paradise. I don't know where you're going to go, but you can. It's a one-way ticket. You have to pay to get back. Okay, so we have a whole bunch of stuff going on today, but we also have a $100 opportunity to win if you get your butt in the chair after break at exactly the right time. So it's best if you can get here quickly and sit down, because if we choose your name and you're not in your chair, you don't win that $100 bill. Oh. It's right here in my pocket. All right, so we are also doing something a little different this year. We are having our online auction. It's you have to sign in to bid, and we're continually adding new things to it, because we kind of got overloaded at the last second with auction items, which we're very grateful for, but then that puts us behind the eight ball. So keep checking back. If you're bidding on things, keep checking back to see what else we've added. So one other thing. I think a lot of people in this room know it, but I'm just gonna confirm it for sure. I'm retiring from the Summit Chamber effective the end of the year. So this is my last breakfast. So anyway, more to follow. I'm not leaving the county, and I am super busy with a whole bunch of other things, but the Summit Chamber was really getting in the way of my ski time. So I was just like, no, this has got to go. Okay, so enjoy yourselves. This is going to be a great, great, great event. And we're just going to give you a couple seconds. Are you going to start right now? Okay, so actually, before Doug gets on here, will you roll the opening video, please?
Wait.
Dear winner, I love the way you rejuvenate me. Oh, I forgot one thing. I always forget something. I promised Elizabeth Lawrence 60 seconds to talk about something very important, so Elizabeth.
Good morning. Thanks for being here. We're going to keep it much shorter than 60 seconds. So I'm Summit County Commissioner Elizabeth Lawrence, and also heading up the census in Summit County in 2020. Why that's important to all of you guys is that Summit County has done a terrible job in the past in responding to the census. Last time around, we had about a 21% response rate. It's really terrible. But we want to be counted, because there's millions of dollars on the line because of this. So where you guys come in another barrier is that the census mails the census to every residential street address. How many in here get your mail at your home? If you live in Summit Cove, yeah, so there's three of you, great. So that's the issue. So they don't mail it to a PO box. So Summit County, we have to go above and beyond and do what's called self-response, which this year, coming up next year in 2020, we can do online. So we're gonna do a huge kickoff, and we really need all employers in the county to tell your employees to please fill out the census and respond, because we have lots of money that is very helpful for Summit County and us to keep going. But it also, we want an accurate count because we know that we're growing and we want to reflect that. So lots to come. Just a reminder, if you're an HR director, we're going to come after you and how you can get your employees to sign the census. And we really look forward to every one of you being counted in Summit County. Thank you.
Dear winter.
Dear winter.
Dear winter, I love the way you rejuvenate me.
Winter, I love you when your days are the shortest and the light is blue and has that magic quality all day long.
I love watching the collected snow fall off the trees.
I love the smell when I come outside and it's been snowing.
The peacefulness and the isolation that you provide is incredible.
You have given me so many incredible memories.
I love my silent steps in your snow.
I love the way you transform the landscape into an amazing playground.
If you wake up in the morning and, you know, and everything is covered with snow and it's really nice and quiet, and so I think it has a magical tint to it.
I love you for connecting me to all my friends.
You make me cry every single day and I can't help it. You just have that power over me.
I feel invigorated and at home with you.
One of those things that leaves you speechless.
I don't know if I can make it without you.
Winter, I love you the most because of how powerful you are. It reminds me every day of my humanity.
I love the silence. It's never as quiet as a winter night. It's unbelievable.
Welcome. My name is Doug Berg. I'm the president of the Summit Chamber of Commerce. And raise your glasses. We'll have a little toast. Winter is coming. It's kind of my theme for the today. And I know Joel Garatz is speaking a little later. Joel, I'm a little sorry to steal your thunder on that one, but it's inevitable. I'd like to thank Dustin Lyman and the entire team at Copper Mountain for hosting this breakfast. I think they've done a wonderful job. Dustin's right over there. Let's give them a big round of applause, please. Also, I'd like to thank Alan Hensroth from A Basin, Rob Goodell from Loveland, John Bueller from Breckenridge, and he's also representing Keystone this morning. Thanks to our sponsor, Centura Health. They'll be speaking next. Summit Orthopedics at Panorama, Excel Energy, Climax Molybdenum, and iFurnish, and so many others. There are other sponsors that are here. It takes a village to put on an event like this, and we're thankful for our sponsors for doing that. We're honored to have Centura Health as our title sponsor. They're a great community partner. Centura Health was instrumental in the creation of our new affordable care partnership with Peak Alliance, and we're looking forward to seeing how much our new lower healthcare rates are gonna help us. Thanks a ton to the work by Centura, Tamara, Julie McCluskey, Mark Spires, and others. And with that, we'll kick off with Centura.
Oh, hey, I'm Lee Boyles, CEO for St. Anthony Summit Medical Center. I'm bummed to be missing this year's Centura Health COO breakfast. I'm out of the county on a work trip, but the truth is I'd much rather be at Copper Mountain this morning sharing in the excitement for the upcoming season with all of you. Fortunately for you, we found someone much more interesting than me to speak on the hospital's behalf, and I'll introduce him in a moment. But first, I just want to say thank you to the Chamber and to our entire business community for all the support you give St. Anthony Summit Medical Center. Living and working in Summit County is such a blessing, and we consider it a privilege to be able to provide world-class healthcare to our residents and visitors. Whether at our hospital, our high country healthcare primary care clinics, our emergency and urgent care clinics at the base of Copper, Breckenridge, and Keystone, Centura Health is proud of our longstanding relationships with the mountain resorts and the communities was serve. Without further ado, I'm honored to introduce a man I've come to know quite well over the past couple months, although we both wish it would have been under much different circumstances. During his amazing journey and his time at our hospital, he even took time to make a lasting impression on my daughter Hayden by sharing his experiences with her, and she hasn't stopped talking about him since that day. But I'll let him tell that story. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, here's Jeff Ashby, and I hope to see you all soon on the slopes.
Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Jeff, and I love the snow. It's great to be here at Copper this morning. It reminded me when I drove in that about 2.5 years ago, I invited a woman for a ski date. It was our first date. It actually, I think, turned out to be a ski test. I wasn't sure who was actually being tested. But last week, I married that woman, and she's over here. Her name is Mary. It was minus 13 that morning when we got on the lift, by the way. She hung in. I want to tell you another story this morning, and that's about why I'm up here on crutches. Last July 15th, I summited La Plata Peak. It's Colorado's fifth highest peak. I summited just before 9 a.m. It was a beautiful, beautiful Colorado morning, still somewhat cold on top with a light breeze. I'd cranked up the mountain that morning, feeling really good. There was one guy I couldn't catch. He turned out to be an ultramarathoner that I talked to at the top, and exchanged some pleasantries with him, ate my peanut butter and jelly sandwich, and turned downhill. 30 minutes later, I was lying in a pile of suitcase-sized boulders at the bottom of a steep snowfield, and I was severely injured. I broke both my legs, one of them multiple times. I broke my arm, which I'm not sure if it was a compound fracture. Fortunately, the bone was back in by the time I looked at it, and both my arms were bleeding from trying to stop myself during a plunge down that snowfield. I lost my cell phone, my watch, my hat, my sunglasses. I was in pretty bad shape. I spent the next 22 hours trying to manage my injuries, splint my leg, and drag myself to a more favorable bivouac spot on the side of this mountain. That ended up being a rock outcropping at about 13,000 feet. I had these great visions that I could drag myself 2 miles like Joel Simpson did in Touching the Void and get help, but the fact of the matter is that I got about 150 feet in 4 hours. By 3 a.m. the next morning, I was badly hypothermic, shivering violently, suffering from exposure. I had begun hallucinating, lapsing into either unconsciousness or sleep. I don't really know which, but I needed some help. And then a voice from above, not the Almighty, but a rescuer from Chaffee County Rescue, a man named Donnie Smith. He is a humble paramedic by day, and in my case, a human mountain goat at night, where he routinely is the first person to reach the injured party. He yelled at me from above. I saw his headlamp up there, about 500 feet above me, and he then climbed down this snowfield, unfamiliar to him at night, under his headlamp, at one point front pointing on his crampons and using his ice axe to get down to me, bringing me warmth and medication. When he reached me, he told me they had a plan to rescue me by helicopter sometime after sunrise. So as I was enjoying my night under the stars with Donnie, unbeknownst to me, it was a beautiful night, by the way. Unbeknownst to me, my family, Mary and my family, were setting up that I be taken to a level one trauma center in Denver. They knew I was hurt badly, and we had a connection down there, and they were setting all that up. But somewhat remarkably, Donnie's radio crackled, and the SAR incident commander asked him to ask me where I wanted to go for treatment, or where I wanted to be taken to. And here I am, I'm a physical wreck, I'm on pain meds, and they're asking me where I want to go. Well, it turns out that years earlier, I had a friend in St. Anthony's Summit Medical Center who was ill, and I went and spent the night there with him to help care for him and give his wife a break. And I remembered that place. There was something about it. I also thought it was closer, and I thought my reasoning was that if they took me there, I would be stabilized and they would send me on to Denver for the orthopedic care that I would certainly need. So I asked to go to St. Anthony's, and they believed me, not my family. At about 9 a.m. that morning, an Army Black Hawk helicopter lifted Donnie and me off the mountain and took us to Twin Lakes, where I was transferred to a Frisco-based Flight for Life helicopter. And that helicopter, with an all-woman crew, go girls, yes, they were awesome. They delivered my wrecked body to Summit Medical Center, where I spent the next 4 weeks. While in that hospital, a number of skilled surgeons that are all sitting right here at the table in front of me, thank you, Rick, Aaron, and Zan, they screwed my bones back together, while other doctors and nurses slowly brought my body back to life. Physical and occupational therapists began working with me to get me to regain my capability and teach me how to move with two broken legs. Can be done. And then chaplains and social workers even came by my room to pray for my recovery and help me sort out some of the deeper things that were going on. The level of personal attention there was absolutely remarkable. It was incredible. Even my family admitted that I had made a good choice, not by crossing the snowfield that day, but by asking to come to Frisco. In those 4 weeks, I began to notice something else, that every single person that left my room, from the cafeteria workers who brought my meals to CEO Lee Boyles, every one of them, before they left my room, asked me if there was anything else they could get me. Is there anything else I can get for you? I heard that hundreds of times, and no one ever left my room without asking me that question. It was incredible culture. So St. Anthony's Summit Medical Center is an incredible facility. I can vouch for that. And I hope that you all recognize it as this amazing resource in your community. And thanks to the staff and the surgeons and the hospital, I am alive and recovering. And the best part is that I expect to be back on my skis, Zan, before the end of the next season. Thank you. So I'm very grateful to Lee Boyles for giving me the opportunity to thank this town, this community this morning, and I thank you all for your time and attention this morning.
Morning, everybody. I'm both the MC and the first presenter this morning, so I got a little confused as to who was going to come up. But I'm also a marketing guy, and I guess the message this morning is hurt yourself here. All right? There's going to be more on that later, but I wanted to help you interpret how this would spin in the overall marketplace. My name is Ralph Garrison. This is my 10th year emceeing or helping out for the Summit County Chamber. I haven't even gotten invited back to Mama's Thanksgiving dinner as frequently or consistently, so I'm appreciative for the opportunity. I'm humbled by the chance to continue to participate in Summit County, and I have for you a little market update, which is flavored a little differently this year by the need to do it crisply, thus the executive summary. Someday I'm going to get paid by the word, but not this day. And a little bit of then and now retrospective about going back to the data that was in my first presentation and comparing it to what we see today. The first one, as we looked forward to the year 2010. This one, as we look forward to the year 2020 in our forward-looking mirror. And for those of you who have been around for a while, you know for sure changes have come to pass, and they seem to be coming even more rapidly as days goes on, both major strategic and minor technical. So then a little review of the last winter season, where things left off, and a quick preview of, well, it's actually a look at the current summer season. We can't see into the winter season well enough to be statistically valid. So the story has been largely about this community as a resort community, and you see on the left, the resort community over these last several decades has moved from day ski areas to destination mountain resorts, and now trying to figure out how to coordinate the interest of the destination guest with those of the local residents and the all-important second homeowners and increasing numbers of retirees that are involved. So simultaneously in many of these resort towns, it's not just about a resort, a purpose-built resort or a historical resort, but it's about the overall community. And we're seeing more and more attention to the community and the values of the residents who make up a significant part. So it used to be maybe all about tourism. Now it seems to be tourism as the fuel for an economic engine that allows all of us to sustain the lifestyle that has brought us here, whether for a few days as a destination guest, and many of us find our way here that time for the first time, or coming longer as a second homeowner, eventually retiring if you're a baby boomer and have a inexplicable urge to grow your hair long, just by way of one example. Or the all-important residents who really make up the heart and the soul of the resort communities as well. So we see this sort of convergence of common interests, and where we once have focused maybe on just the resort vacation side, the research that is related to that, we're increasingly spend more time really understanding the residents, the second homeowners, and that balance about which I'm speaking. So we're seeing a change in the organizational infrastructure as our interests changed and our need to reconcile a community that is no longer growing like it used to. It's maturing these days. We're all growing up in one way or another, it seems, in the process. So much more focus on the residents, the second homeowners, and the retirees that make up the overall resort community. I saw this card, and I'm going to pause for a moment and let you digest it. It takes a moment. This seems to be a sort of common sentiment, you know, that a lot of us have that really have to do with the reason that we do the things we do, the lifestyle about which we're speaking. So whether you came for a day or a weekend or frequent, consume Summit County in any number of ways, this seems to be one of the common denominators that bond us all together. The need to be able to sustain ourselves while we do this, and the need to protect it so it is sustainable in and of itself on down the road. Those don't reconcile easily and by themselves. All right, so taking a look from then and now, a little graphic that is about a 12-year graphic, but we started in 2009. We're going to this time frame, and I'm showing you the three key metrics that Destometrics tracks, the company that I worked for until a couple of years ago when it sold and I went on airplane mode, as I've been calling it. Since that time. Unemployment at that time had peaked to what is a recent high and has since dropped down to very remarkable and favorable levels. for the overall economy. Those of you who are looking for good help may be a little more challenging as that goes on. Consumer confidence had gone down as low as 25 on a scale that started at 100, is now at 135. That's higher demand out there in the marketplace in terms of the confidence that consumers have in spending discretionary dollars, extra time, extra money to take vacations. A positive number is a good thing, and you can see that it's climbed consistently. Well, frankly, it's climbed inconsistently. Consumers are that way, you see. Ever since that near low back in just prior to 2009, and if you wanted a little indication about how Wall Street feels about all this instead of Main Street, the Dow Jones is the indicator we use. You notice that it grew fairly consistently. It started to hiccup a little bit more. We, the consumers, can't seem to figure out what we, the federal government, is doing with our economy right now. There's apparently some tweets involved somewhere in that process. Usually there's a significant change that will have occurred by now as a result of the tweets coming out after morning coffee. Enough of that. Taking another look, of course, as we begin to contemplate winter, skier visits, this is NSAA skier visits, going well back into the mid-1980s, but last year 59 million, buoyed by good snow really through all of the West. Good snow for the benefit of the destination guests who come for that purpose, good snow for the season's pass holders, increasingly number of you that take advantage of great season's pass deals. Once you got the pass and the skiing's free and it's good, it doesn't get much better than that, and it didn't this last year, you can see. Good numbers posted across the country and specifically in the West as we look at that last 10-year scenario. Overall, the number of skiers is not increasing. The number of skier visits goes back and forth depending upon the magnet of the snow equity that we build up over time. So there's been a slight drop in skier visits as folks in the winter do more things with their times. We're diversifying, there are more eggs or more baskets for our eggs. That's not a bad thing economically, but by no doubt, the primary attraction and the big dollars continue to be the gravity sports that are represented by the numerous mountains, more in Summit County than anywhere else in the country. So if we look at an overall year-over-year change with lodging, that's a proxy for the destination guest, and we put all of the numbers at zero in 2007-08, then I proxied these last 10 years to see the change in occupancy, that's in orange, the change in rate, that's in blue. If you change occupancy and rate both, you affect overall revenue, and that's the overall change that you see in the red. So winter destination visitation in Summit County, as Destinometrics measures it, has gone up 35%, about 3.5% per year, more based on revenue than based on occupancy. So that's what this story tells, how the winter has matured, and I'll show you a little bit more about a sneak peek in short order. The yellow dotted line is the change in overall skier visits during that same time. So you can see slightly more guests, but not spending quite as much time on the mountain. That's the story from this 11-year trend. And as I talked to you all about summer last year, I was looking for attractions that would bring guests from far enough away that would help grow our summer business. This is a little video. Some of you who were here might remember, but this was somebody's idea of a summer attraction. Turns out that while an intriguing concept, it really didn't scale. So we found other attractions, and as many of you know, summer has grown much more rapidly, percentage-wise, than winter. It still doesn't represent more revenue, but there's been a much greater growth in visitation over these last several years, as you can see by these numbers, where if we put our 10-year markers on it, occupancy has gone up 35%, rate about 50%, multiply those together, over 100% increase. But you also see for the first time, and on the far right, what we're projecting of the balance of this year, which is a slowing of summer occupancy for the first time in these last years. Growth can't continue to accelerate forever, and May and early June was a low start for summer because it was a high ending for winter. Apparently you can't have your cake and eat it too, although I hope we continue to try. So a little slow start for the summer, a little uncertainty in September and October, as you'll see later, although most of us know September is just a magnificent month to be in the mountains, and most of the universe is figuring that out. It's lapping into October as well. A couple of other monikers. This is overall real estate sales and values, and I'm just going to draw a couple of lines there over that 10-year notion to show that real estate valuation pegged at about $600,000 average has moved favorably. This is great news if you own a property prior to 2009. If you're trying to get in or sold at the wrong time, well, how do we know? Nonetheless, there is indication of positive economic growth across the board since 2009, in part because we were 1 year into the Great Recession. That's when I started making references to adult beverages in almost all of my presentations. I couldn't really think of a better spin on it. Also a new evolution, and that is the consolidation in the resort industry, all industries for that matter, which is familied around now two family networks. The epic one that we've all known about that sort of started the game, and a much more recent and aggressive Icon Pass. This is just some indications of the mountains that are part of that family, either by being owned and operated or by an affiliation network, as you see on the outside. But the story continues to evolve, and there was an announcement a couple of months ago and just a closing a couple of days ago about a family of mostly Northeastern breeder-freeder resorts that have become part of the EPIC program. So what does that mean to Summit County? Well, EPIC has been represented ably and since the beginning by Keystone and Breck. A-Basin has been riding that train. It probably isn't surprised that Copper chose the Icon Pass family to provide compliment to you and all the destination's guests. But wait, there's change afoot. A-Basin has jumped ship for some reason I do not know, and we are going to find out by the time the morning is done. Now, whether we ask A-Basin or Keystone Breckenridge, I guess will depend on who goes last. In the overall conversation, I don't think there's any dirt here at all, but I'll do my best. And Loveland, who has an interesting place in the crown jewel of resorts, when we add Loveland to the rest of the skier visits, Summit County, Colorado has more skier visits than any other state except California. So we use Loveland when it's to our convenience, and then not. Their Powder Alliance is a group of independents. And there's a real, you know, there's a market for folks that aren't so interested in what the rest of the destination resorts can't help but become, you know, as they satisfy their ability to really provide a great product for a lot of people, as is consistent with the business case out there. But something for everybody is not at all a bad thing. And it's been my pleasure to work with a number of resort leaders, and I thought these people had lifelong contracts because from when I went started in 2010 to 2015, there were really no changes at all until Vail Resorts got the memo that it was smart to move their COOs every couple of years. I'm making this up, of course. But it would seem that there's a silent music somewhere in Vail Resorts corporate, and then the chairs move. And that introduced Mike, brought John over to Breck, and by 2017, Jeff joined. We had Jeff visiting us for a couple of different times. Last year, Gary moved on. Jesse Tru took over for a year and has now been joined by Dustin Lyman, who we'll be introduced to a little later this morning. And just recently, Jeff's departure has been announced. Keystone is otherwise unrepresented, but thanks to the dual personality, you will be greeted by John Buhner Jr. and John Sr. himself. It'll be up to you to figure out which version of John is speaking at what time, but his station in Keystone for some years in Breckenridge makes him as informed, to represent the big guns as probably anybody is, and much of the story is going to turn out to be about big guns, so the pun is intended. All right, in the organizational infrastructure, you know, we organize our communities by destination marketing organizations, but it's not just about marketing. If we're filled, it's more about mitigation and management and controlling our visitation and our work-life balance, focusing on shoulder seasons and low seasons to bring those up to take the pressure off high seasons. So the shift is more toward a year-round sustainable economy, and the Breckenridge Resort Chamber is one example, a local example, of the morphing of what a DMO had done to what it is doing now, adding the word management to the functions and mitigation of growth. So it's a quality and quantity discussion. This is work that they did with a destination management plan that was focused on the residents over this past year in cooperation with the city. Their mission statement, I paraphrased, is trying to create some harmony, you know, between the quality of life that we represent and what the space, what our platform provides for us. So that's one version. I also want to just brag on the Summit County Chamber that doesn't do a very good job of bragging on itself. But in 2009, deep cum chi would be one phrase that I think I heard in a planning session about how the chamber thought its efforts were being received in Summit County. But nothing like a recession to cause people to pay a little more attention to good business. And I think they rode that wave with some energy, although a lot has changed. Judy and Mark Nunn, as custodians of the Chamber of Commerce, hasn't changed over this decade. And I'd like you to join me just for a minute in acknowledging their participation. Now the chamber has been involved in a long recovery. They are at their highs in all of the indexes that they talk about. Over 400 active members, dues, incomes, is augmented by other kinds of incomes. I think this event has sold out for each of the 10 years. They don't struggle to raise price as I would in yield management. They struggle to keep price down because they think their business is to bring these kinds of events to you guys in the most affordable way process. It seems to be all about you. I forget that sometimes. So the Summit Chamber now has been able to pull together a group of disparate chambers under one umbrella to coordinate their efforts, not in like a crankshaft would. And I applaud this kind of organizational structure and the work that went into its accomplishment. It's an example of your resort community maturing. So quickly, the last winter season is the only winter season that we've got really to talk to you much about. We're using the Destimetrics data that you've become familiar with. And the destinations that are in Summit County are the ones you see in yellow. When I talk about the industry, it's all the rest of them, the major resorts across the western United States. This is following the medical theme, hurt yourself here. This is an EKG. It's really actually representing skier visits. And you're looking at the last year and the year before in that line across the top. And you can see they're roughly the same with some adjustments. The horizontal line is the year-over-year change. And you can see changes occur as groups come and go, as holiday seasons move. But overall, the season was pretty consistent year-over-year this last year. It behaved consistently with previous years, and you have become more and more consistently behaved. Even when snow and the economy are varying, your behavior, your visitation behavior is balancing itself out. I use a strike zone. It's sort of the economic target. If you get more than about 90% practical occupancy, you're just too busy, right? There's crowds and consequences. So when you go across the top of the yellow line, you know, those are times when we don't need more visitation, we need better management. Down at the bottom line, really, that's not enough economic justification to keep the lights on. So we try to focus on the middle scenario. Your winter season is much so, but you see there are a lot of opportunities to fill in the mid-season valleys. That makes sense when you're as close to the Front Range as you guys are. You benefit and you curse from that. This is a quick look at overall change in occupancy and rate. You see occupancy went up. Rate was relatively flat. Comparing Summit County on the right to the industry on the left, you're close enough to be saying that you're following the overall industry. You're a big enough piece to almost be that. These are numerical changes in occupancy. You see it on the top, and rate. You have a slightly higher occupancy, but a slightly lower rate. You're a better value would be a way to spin that in the consumer marketplace than some of the other resorts that price more for this is lodging in this particular case. So that's probably a plus in the overall drill. Using the same drill for summer 19, we're well into the 19 season, which started in May and will end at the end of October. But we can see the guests who have come and gone and all the guests that are also on the books now. So that's the better part of them. And you can see the right-hand side of the graph is confusing because that business hasn't completed. But the rest of the graph seems to follow pretty much the same pattern that it has last summer. I already told you that the early season was a little low, and you can see that in the bar across the left. You can also see the schizophrenic changes in groups moving to the right and the left. Groups are a big part of this September-October season, and that's what happens when a group moves from one time to the other. This data reveals that information, and those of you retailers who are trying to figure out how to staff and the like might want to keep track of this data, because you can move your staffing and your food and beverage according to the groups to the better efficiency of all concerned. Strike zone doesn't show as much capacity problem at the top, shows more opportunity at the bottom, so shoulder seasons is the target of opportunity. Once again, comparing your data to the broader industry's data, Great Summit County down a little overall. Occupancy, about the industry. ADR is about the same. Overall revenue is about the same. Once again, there are no outliers in Summit County's behavior. So that's a quick summary of the then and now, a little look at the last winter season, a little look at where we are this summer season. As we look forward into this coming winter season, the advanced reservation data that we rely on is not thick enough to be predictive. It's showing the same general trends that last year did, with more focus on holiday seasons and less focus on shoulder seasons of the year. But that typically happens early on because people make their reservations for holiday seasons earlier. So the story has not yet been told. The data is as confusing as it is valuable, and I've chosen to talk about it instead of show it to you as a result. So that concludes my comments, and I look forward to moving forward now with the balance of the agenda. That was Ralph, the presenter. Thank you, Ralph. You're welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Kind of got to self-manage, you know. Next up on the list, and I'm going to run the risk of putting this medical theme, you know, too pervasive, but I'd like to introduce Rick Bowles. Rick is representing our next presenter and started his career out in engineering, first academically, and then working for several large companies before he found himself in a really serious accident, which put him in touch with orthopedics, I'll say, in general. You can imagine what might be involved there. But his interest in that put him back into a new career where he went to school at night until he was successful becoming a physician, changing into the medical so that he could help others the way that they helped him. And he finds himself now specializing in sports medicine and leading an organization on your behalf, another great place, or indication of a great place to hurt yourself here in Summit County. Rick, tell us a story.
That's a tough act to follow, but good morning, Summit County. I'm excited to be standing in front of such a great group as we kick off another ski season. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Dr. Rick Bowles with Panorama Summit Orthopedics. Panorama Summit Orthopedics is part of Panorama Orthopedics and Spine Center in Golden, and I know many of you are familiar with our group there as patients. Through our partnership with Centura Health, this will be our second season taking care of the orthopedic needs for the entire Summit County community, as well as being the orthopedic providers for the ski clinics at Breck, Copper, and Keystone. I'd like to introduce my partners here with me today, Dr. Aaron Black and Dr. Zan Corville. Like all of the surgeons at Panorama, both here and in Denver, the three of us are fellowship trained in orthopedic subspecialties. Dr. Black is a specialist in orthopedic sports medicine and trauma. Dr. Corville is a specialist in orthopedic foot and ankle surgery and trauma. Like Dr. Black, I am also a specialist in orthopedic sports medicine and trauma. Are you sensing a pattern here with the trauma? Turns out not everyone is as good a skier as they believe themselves to be, so we had quite a busy winter. Our mission at Panorama Summit Orthopedics is to provide the absolute best patient care to everyone in Summit County. From the ski patrollers and the skiers they rescue, to the local business owners, their employees, and the executive second homeowners, and everyone in between. Nearly everyone in Summit County is an athlete at some level, from recreational to professional. And that's honestly what makes our job so much fun. We get to see all these people recover and return to the sports that we all love. And that's honestly also why we all make our homes here in Summit County. Dr. Corville and I both live in Breckenridge, and Dr. Black lives in Frisco. You may see us around skiing and snowboarding, cycling and climbing, even having a beer at RMU or Outer Range, just enjoying the active lifestyle that makes Summit County so unique. We had a great season last year, and we're looking forward to an even better one this year. Our team includes three indispensable orthopedic PAs and four awesome clinical liaisons who help us coordinate care at both in the clinics and at the hospital. And our office staff, the front desk, our insurance coordinator, our radiology tech, and our practice manager are the best I've seen in any medical office anywhere. Our patients' experience is second to none, and we work very hard to keep it that way. As a result, business is booming. We just opened our physical therapy office on Main Street in Breck back in April. And in addition to hiring a fourth orthopedic PA and another orthopedic surgeon, who is also fellowship trained in, you guessed it, orthopedic trauma, we are expanding our orthopedic subspecialty coverage with hand surgeons who will be seeing patients here and doing surgery at St. Anthony's Summit Medical Center. You might wonder where we're going to put all these people, and you'd be right to ask that question because we are rapidly outgrowing our space at our office in Silverthorne. So fortunately, we're in the midst of building our brand new office building in Frisco, right off School Road. If you've seen the steel going up behind the Vista Medical Building, you've seen our new space. And we couldn't be more excited about moving into that space and opening in late spring of 2020. We look forward to seeing everyone on the slopes this season, hopefully not in the emergency department. And let's all cross our fingers we have another great snow year. Now for some administrative items regarding the auction. Summit Orthopedics is proud to sponsor today's auction. There are a lot of exciting things you don't want to miss, from season passes for many of our amazing ski slopes to an opportunity to ski with a COO. You don't want to miss out. And since this year's auction is online, you need to register to bid if you haven't done that already. Visit the auction table under the Summit Orthopedics banner for more details on how to register and bid, because a portion of the proceeds benefits the Chamber's Education Fund. Thank you very much.
Rick was afraid to follow Ralph, I had to follow a good-looking doctor. You guys thought you were getting rid of me last year, didn't you? Judy made me pay to do this year, so thanks for having us. Another thing I have a problem with today at Copper is Justin, our executive chef here, hired a new pastry chef. Did you see that pastry? That is like my weakness. I'm like, what are you doing? It's amazing. I want to just compliment on their food this morning and those pastries. My name is Tony Pistello, and Kelly and I are the owners of iFurnish in Frisco. We're a furniture store that started about 10 years ago. And we're so excited to be part of this community. When we started it, we wanted to really get involved in the community and try and help a lot of the nonprofits and different things, and we couldn't do it without the support of everybody in this room, and we want to thank you for that. You guys have just stepped up and supported us like we just couldn't expect, so thank you so much for doing that, and we appreciate all your support and in our stores and with the resorts and just a ton of people in here, so thank you so much. I got some other exciting news, and I'm going to take, you know, Rob Goodell's bathroom theme usually, and let you know that we have two new ADA accessible bathrooms coming, but they're not in our Frisco store. We have a new location in Kremling now too, and we're putting in two new bathrooms. So, AJ, my oldest son, and his wife Kelsey are gonna be running that store, and he's here today. And we have another team member, Caleb Orrick, who's in charge of hospitality stuff with the resorts, and you guys probably know him. He's involved a lot, so thank you for that too. You know, iFurnish Night Mattress, when we opened, we also tried to provide an affordable, fashionable furniture option here in Summit County, so you didn't have to, you know, make the drive one way or another, and you could stay right here and do it right here in Summit County. And We'll continue to do that here and in Kremling and wherever else we hopefully, you know, go to. But we just can't thank everybody enough here that has supported us, and we really appreciate that. And it's our honor to be here and be able to support the community and the COO Breakfast. This is an amazing event, and it's just awesome to see all these familiar faces every year. I could talk all day about our store and what we do, but we are honored here today with an amazing person, and I think everybody knows Joel Gratz. And I'm going to do a little bio on him. He is probably the most famous, right, meteorologist in Colorado. I gave him crap earlier this morning. The only job you can have and be, you know, 50% right and still have a job. But, you know, he's going to prove me wrong on that, I think. He's got stats, and he's kind of like Ralph. He's got all that stuff. We're hoping we have a great year like we had last year. We might call it, you know, I don't know, La Nina, La Nada, I don't know what it's called, but he'll tell us more about that as well. He's the founding meteorologist, and I got to read this because it's big words. And he has the website, opensnow.com. I think everybody probably has it. There's an app, there's a website. And if you don't have it on your phone, you should have it on your phone because he is probably more accurate than 50%. And it's my go-to every day. He earned his a degree in meteorology from Penn State. And then he got his MS and MBA from University of Colorado. Well, as we know, he's a diehard skier, biker, hiker. He does it with his wife, Lauren, and his son, Levi, who weren't able to make it today. But I want to see, I think Levi's what, 2? Is he on skis yet? Oh yeah, so or boards or whatever you choose, but pretty impressive. His first email went out. Guess how many people were on it? 38. 38 people were on his first email, and to take what he's done, and now look at what he's done. It's I got to tell you, it is 2.5 million, right, Joel? 2.5 million. So back in 2007. 38 people. Talk about statistics, Ralph, in 10, 12 years. 2.5 million people follow opensnow.com. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce Joel Gratz. It's my honor. Thank you.
I'm going to be really clear there. Thank you guys very much for having me today. And summer's nice. I get to relax. I get to sleep in a little bit. But this is exciting. It's cold. The leaves are turning. We start looking at snow. So let's get right to it. Just a quick little bit. Meteorologists, something happens, snowstorm, hurricane, tornado. We know by elementary school that we want to be a meteorologist. That's just the deal. I was a ski racer. I was not very good. I was kind of risk adverse, which doesn't make you a good ski racer, but I did enjoy skiing and learning how to ski on the loose granular of the East. I went to Penn State. Any Penn Staters in here? A few. There's always a few. Very good. So I love meteorology, graduated with a degree in meteorology. My first powder day was not until I was about 20 years old, and it was out in Lake Tahoe visiting a friend. I was like, whoa, what is this stuff? This is cool. This isn't loose granular. This is amazing. And then I moved out here for grad school, and the first year I missed a 12-inch day. I wasn't up here. And I got mad. I was like, I don't know, I'd rather be skiing powder. Why was I not up there? The next year, I missed 48 inches and 48 hours, a storm in November, and I was really, really mad. And at that moment, I decided I have a degree in meteorology, I have a passion, a sickness for powder, and I need to combine these two so I do not miss another powder day. Started telling some friends, and that was Colorado Powder Forecast, and eventually Open Snow, and here we are. So, and it's not just me, of course. My wife loves to ski. My little kiddo on the right side up there was 19 months at A Basin jumping on the magic carpet. So we're all having a good time as a family. All right, let's talk about the good stuff. Last season. This is a map of snowpack on March 31st. Blue is good. Those numbers show about 130 to 150% of average snowpack by the end of March last season, and I circled the general area of Summit County there. How does that make you feel? The coffee has kicked in, the maps are looking good, big thumbs up, absolutely. So let's talk about what made last season special, and it's not just amount of snow. And I think you all know this, but it's not just the total amount of snow you get across 6 months that makes a season good or bad. There are certain nuances to it. This graph is the snowpack going from zero on the bottom left to its peak at the end of March, early April, kind of in the middle, and then dropping off back to zero in June or July. The green line is the average over about 30 years. The black line is what happened last year, and the shading shows regions from the most snow we've ever had to the least snow we've ever had over 30 years. And this is for the upper Colorado River Basin, so generally here in Summit, but it's roughly the same across the state from last year. So what do we notice? Solid start. We had a couple big storms in October and early November. Really important, not just to get people excited, but to set a good base. So you can see that black line notched up and then came down a little bit and notched up. Couple big storms. Here's the key. So not just early start, but consistent storms. If that black line is going sideways, that means it's dry. If that black line is going up, and to the right, that means it's snowing. We don't really see any sideways in the meat of the season last year in December, January, and February. And that's the key. We didn't go weeks and weeks and weeks without snow. That happens. It's normal. It can happen. But it didn't happen last year, which is awesome. And decreases the hate mail in my inbox quite a bit. So we had consistent storms. And then I'm sure you all remember in early March, big finish. That week was just nutso when it just snowed and snowed and snowed, and we had historic avalanches. Not awesome, but very interesting from a weather and science perspective. And then it kept going and going and going. So what you'll notice is that black line nearly touched record levels, but it actually didn't ever. And for most of the season, it was above average, but it wasn't record. But when we think about what made last year so special was the consistency, not necessarily total amount of snow. And that's the key, consistency. How do you feel about last season? Exactly. Big thumbs up. All right, so the number one question. This season's outlook. You ready for this? Drum roll, please. Yep, that's all I got. Both due to time restrictions and science restrictions, that literally is the only slide in all I'm going to say about this season. That's it. Here's the deal. Last season, nobody predicted it. When you look at, and we just wrote an article a couple weeks ago looking at about 10 forecasts for last season nationwide versus what actually happened with snow and temperatures, nothing was really that close. Maybe a seasonal forecast is right in one region, but wrong in a lot of regions. Maybe one outlet gets a seasonal forecast right and five get it wrong, and that can kind of switch. There is no consistency in any one organization or forecast model getting a forecast right for a winter, three-month season, year in and year out consistently. There just isn't. It's just not there. So it's really fun to talk about in August and September. What's going to happen? There is virtually no accuracy to that statement. And here's the deal. Even if we could say with some amount of accuracy, here's what December, January, and February will look like on average, it doesn't really tell you, is it going to be one big dump for 2 weeks and then it's dry? Is it consistent snowfall? Is it good region here and not there? We just don't No. So there you go. It will snow. Likely not as much as you want it to, because everybody wants more, including me. And that's the official forecast, and we'll just start tracking storms as they come in. There we go. And trust me, if there was a way to accurately predict the winter consistently and I was confident in it, I would be more than happy to bring it to you. But it's just not there. So let's talk about what we can do more than 51% of the time. When are forecasts reliable? This is really key. You can go to a lot of apps, a lot of websites, and get forecasts out to 15 days, 45 days, 90 days. I have people email me, hey, my wedding's in 37 days and AccuWeather said there's a chance of rain. Should I be worried? No, don't worry about that. Make sure the catering's taken care of. Like, don't worry about the weather 37 days out. So what can we do? Right? A lot of people make fun of meteorology. I get it. But I started this game, 30 years ago when I was growing up. It has improved a lot. So let's talk about that. 8 to 10 days out, what I look at and what the stats say is the general temperature outlook, the weather pattern outlook, we have some measure of predictability. So remember, 8 to 10 days out. This graph is from the most reliable computer model in the world. This goes over the last 20 years, 1988 in the bottom left to now in the right. This is the accuracy. This is when the accuracy of a temperature outlook achieves some level of reliability. We started 20 years ago, you could only really forecast out about 5 days with some measure of reliability. This is just the temperature outlook. Warmer than average, colder than average, pretty much average. Now, if it's colder than average, you can kind of guesstimate, hey, maybe we'll have some snowstorms, right? But this is not saying it's going to be 12 inches 9 days from now. This is just saying, hey, we're trending colder. So 20 years ago, we could only do that out to 5 days. Now, we're in the 8 to 10 day range. And you see we've plateaued a little bit out there, but still, 8 to 10 days is pretty good as an indication of, hey, a little over a week from now, there could be a storm, some cold. Excellent. When you see 14-day forecasts of a possibility of snow and 6 inches, probably don't trust that one. But 8 to 10 days out, we're good, mostly. Now, 6 to 7 days out is when I start thinking about, could there be a storm, and about when? So let's look at this. Similar type of graph, last 20 years, this is when we achieved some measure of accuracy in individual storms. Not 12 inches at Breckenridge on Thursday morning, that's still a little tricky, but just will there be a storm on Wednesday, Thursday? Used to be only about 5 days out, now we're around 6 to 7 days, 6.5 to 7 days. And finally, when do I start thinking about locking in the details? About 3 to 5 days out. So this is the accuracy of forecasts for the storm details. Kind of how much snow-ish, about when, about where. Below 60% on this graph, effectively meteorology says almost no accuracy or reliability. Don't worry about it. 7 days is getting better, which is what I just showed, but look at 5 and look at 3. Once you get to 3 days before a storm, we're getting pretty close to 100%. Not that we know every last detail, but we know about when the storm's coming, about where it's tracking. So to throw that together again, 8 to 10 days out, hey, is there something that's gonna be interesting? Should I start moving some meetings around? 6 to 7 days out, like, yeah, I'm really looking at my calendar now and just kind of hedging and moving that doctor's appointment. Or looking for extra daycare. And then 3 to 5 days out is when I start texting friends and start saying, okay, who's coming with me? Where are we going? Where are we driving to? Stuff like that. So if you see 12-day forecast for 14 inches of snow at your favorite location, wouldn't pay too much attention to that. But in this metric, 8 to 10 days for the pattern, 6 to 7 days for a storm, 3 to 5 days for the details, pretty reasonable. All right. Let me end with before I do that, here's the forecast. Can we go back? I'm so sorry. And if we can't, thank you. Okay, here's the forecast for the next 5 days. There's Colorado. There is a big storm, just probably not here. Don't worry about it. It's September. It doesn't really matter. And the leaves will stick around longer anyway, so that's good. So the storm's going to stick around to our west. And as it gets closer to Colorado next Tuesday, Wednesday, it might brush us with a little bit of high elevation snow. It's just not going to be a big deal. There is no correlation between early season snowfall and the rest of the season, so just don't worry about it. It's totally fine. All right, last detail, and then I might have time for one or two questions. Wind direction is the key to big powder days. So this is an overview map of Summit County. There's Loveland, A-Basin, Keystone, Breckenridge, and Copper. We have a couple big mountain ranges to our east and south. We have the Gore Range, and we have the Northern Sawatch up around Mount Holy Cross. If we get winds from the east, south, or southwest, they are effectively blocked by those mountain ranges, and then the air goes up those mountain ranges, descends into Summit County. Air going down is not good for snow. We want air to go up. So there are some tricks to this, but basically an east, south, or southwest wind is not awesome. What is awesome is a northwest wind for Loveland, a northwest wind for Copper and Breckenridge, and west for Keystone, A-Basin, and Loveland as well. If you get the wind direction right with the forecast, you're going to be in the ballpark of who gets the most powder about two-thirds of the time. Other factors are in there too, but wind direction is a real big one. So if you read my writing, this is what I focus on quite a bit. All right, last thing for everybody in this room, a little preseason special. In addition to the support we get from a lot of folks here in Summit who are advertising sponsors, we also make some revenue off of subscriptions, longer range forecast, and a few other features. If you would like, feel free to go to Open Snow, use the code COO2019. You get your first year for $1. And that'll be good through the end of September. So thank you guys for your support. And by my stopwatch, I have 1 minute and 7 seconds to take a question or two. So throw it at me. What do you got? Raise your hand or yell it out. Yes. The question is, those charts I showed for accuracy, which, by the way, are not my personal accuracy, it's for a global weather model, but that impacts our accuracy. You saw some plateauing. Will that plateau continue, or will we keep getting better? No idea. Smartest people in the world are working on it. With better computing power, better satellites, we'll probably get better. Whether we can notch that up or it's just a slow, steady growth, I don't know. It will probably keep getting better, but you never know when those step functions are going to occur. One more question. Yes? The only time we would get skunked by northwest flow is if the storm itself is a little too far away. So we lack moisture, we lack kind of the energy, even though we have the northwest wind. So northwest wind by itself isn't sufficient. You need moisture, you need energy with the storm. But if you have the moisture and you have the energy, then the northwest wind is kind of that last kickoff factor. One more. Anybody? Stump me. I think it's colder at A-Basin than Loveland because Al, I think, just in... Do you install some air conditioning this summer? No. I don't know. I don't know that deal. I just focus on powder. But we have a whole segment of that. Of this presentation where we can get that question answered. Guys, I will be around. I love to talk weather. I'll be around during break, and you can always email me too at joel@opensnow.com. Thank you so much, guys. Can you do me one more favor? Can I take a picture of everybody when you're super happy? How do you feel when it's a powder day? There you go. Thank you. Thanks, guys. And now, I would like to, this is the best introduction possible. I should do this, because it's just trivia. I'd like to introduce Nell Warham, Manager of Strategic Community Development at Climax Mine. I'm a good forecaster, not a good reader, apparently. Here's the deal. Did you know that there was also a ski hill and a rope tow at the town of Climax on Chalk Mountain in the late 50s and early 60s? I didn't know that. That's pretty cool.
Joel's been helping me plan my call in too well for work days for 10 years. Thank you, Joel. Yes, Nell Wareham, I'm up at Climax Mine. I was also kind enough not to make you say molybdenum, Joel. Wasn't that sweet of me? So a huge thank you to Copper Mountain for hosting this. You know, we are located just up the hill on Fremont Pass at, you know, 11,300 feet, where we sometimes mine more snow than molybdenum, especially last winter. Copper Ski Patrol is helpful partners with us. They actually help us blast the Iron Mask, which is above our water treatment plant, so keeping us safe. We really appreciate that. We love winter as well, and we love being part of this event and the Summit Chamber. So I'm going to kind of try to keep us on time. Because we've all had a busy summer and a busy winter, this is the 15 minutes to keep us on track where you can go talk to your friends before winter takes off, right? So make sure to get in those silent auction bids. Go talk to everyone. Remember that Judy is going to give one lucky person $100 if you are back in your seats at 9:29 so that we can hear from all of our COOs. So go enjoy your networking break, and thank you so much for being here.
Epic. Okay, so play the commercial, please. Thanks.
Epic Mountain Express makes getting to your Colorado ski vacation easy. We're the only mountain shuttle company with a staff check-in counter at Denver International Airport. Or skip the counter and check in using your mobile phone. Once on board, you can relax, enjoy the free Wi-Fi, and take in the scenery. No need to worry about the mountain road conditions. Our drivers are well-trained, winter driving professionals. You'll arrive at the resort rested and ready for fun. Call or reserve online at epicmountainexpress.com.
And now, the part of the show that we all came for and been waiting for, now that we've got the warm-up bands and so forth taken care of, our sponsors acknowledged, and Ralph's 10-year retrospective of the rearview mirror of Summit County. We will be going through presentations by the COOs from our Summit County Area 5, led off by our host today, Dustin Lyman, who is new to many of us compared to the other old timers. I'm going to invite Dustin up to the stage and to have an opportunity to talk with you a little bit, introduce himself as he sees fit. And with that, Dustin.
It's all yours. All right, thank you. Welcome, everybody. It was a fantastic breakfast, and there are a lot of things that go on at this resort that I have nothing to do with, and breakfast is one of them. And so thank you very much, Justin and team. Fantastic. So first and foremost, we have a video to share. Everybody excited.
So let me tell you a little bit about myself. Yes, I am new, although I've grown up in Colorado. I'm born and raised in Boulder, Colorado. I've been a skier my entire life. Have been, since the days I was brown bag, ended up to Eldora, A-Basin, Loveland, and if I was lucky, up to Copper, Brack, Keystone, all of the resorts. I've never had a bad time at a ski resort. I've always had a good time. I wanted to make it my life from an early age. It took kind of a winding path to get here, so I went to Wake Forest on a football scholarship. CU was looking in other directions at that time. made the most of it. Was ended up being a third round draft pick for the Chicago Bears. I found a lot of people from the NFC North here in Colorado. So, unfortunately, a lot of people from Green Bay and Minnesota too, though. So, no, it's been great. I played played tight end in Chicago for 5 years. When I stopped playing football, I stayed in Chicago for another 5 years, went to University of Chicago for a business degree, decided I wanted to get back to Colorado, knew I wanted to be in the ski industry, and I went first to Aspen and looking for a job, and they offered me a job, but I had two kids at the time. We ate a lot and realized I was going to starve to death on what they had offered me. So I wasn't able to start my career there, but I did find a home with Vail Resorts in Broomfield. And when I was there, I had a great experience. Had the opportunity to look up to people like John Buehler and Alan Hensroth, who were part of the Epic family at that time. And really, it was my ambition to pursue a career in the industry. And I'm really lucky, fortunate, and humbled to be where I'm at right now at Copper Mountain. Also, I'm really lucky and happy to be in Summit County. I've been very impressed with the community here, and I'm getting to know a lot of people. And for those of you that may not know me, you may know my wife. She's from New Jersey, and she tends to meet people a lot easier than I do. So anyway, it has been great being up here in Summit County. We knew we wanted to be up here for a long time. We actually were so smart. We bought a lot of land up here back at when the chart was down at the low end of the range, which no, actually we weren't smart. We just knew we wanted to be here. And so we've got a foothold in the community a long time ago, and we're lucky enough last year to move up here permanently. So I've got four kids, as you can see. They're all in Summit County schools, and we've been very, very impressed with the teachers, the administrators, and the community members. It's just been a fantastic 11 months for us. So thank you to everybody that helps build this community up here. Talking about Copper right now is actually a pretty easy task. We've put, through Powder Corp, $100 million into this resort. So it's fantastic. I think finally someone realized just how wonderful the terrain and this mountain is here at Copper and decided that the return on investment justifies this significant investment. So one of the things we've got is the biggest project in the Powder portfolio right now is a replacement to Solitude, our mid-mountain lodge. What we're putting in up there is a new facility, 25,000 square feet, 180 degree views. It's two stories. It will load directly off the gondola into the second level of it. A really truly transformational building, incredible. It will be a jewel for Summit County. We're really proud of it. It's gonna take us a while to build it. As you might know, it's kind of hard to build up there on the mountain when you only have a 4 month window to actually do construction. This is what it looks like right now. This is what it will look like except covered in snow when you get up there in November and December. But American Eagle was replaced last year. The gondola will load right onto the platform entering in at the second level. So very exciting. It's really gonna be beautiful. Even more exciting probably for this crowd is the new Tucker Mountain lift that we're installing. So Tucker Mountain, if anyone has taken the Snowcat back there in the years that the Snowcat was running, will know just how exciting that terrain is. Most of it's double black, a lot of it's expert only. The lift that we're putting in there is 3,100 feet long, goes 1,200 vertical feet. The top terminal is about 12,400 feet.
It takes about 6 minutes to get up there on the lift now. Took about 45 minutes to get back there on the cat. So we're excited. There's going to be a lot of laps being done out there. It's going to be difficult, so make sure you do your preseason workouts. So that's the look from Tucker this summer. It's beautiful. All that winter weather we got really made everything look green. In order to talk about a difficult construction project, the people working on this have been hiking up from the bottom every single day. So, and I started tallying results, and I think a record is right around between 20 and 25 minutes. The more scenic view takes about 45 to an hour. That's the only one I'm familiar with. Another thing that we've been doing here at Copper is just the concert series. So we've had a lot of live music up here. We have Snow Station through the wintertime, Sun Station in the spring, Copper Live throughout our summer months. It's been exciting. We've had some great bands, and I think we've got a video here. It was really a lot of fun, and a lot of credit to our events team. That's something that we take a lot of pride in here at Copper, is we want to be a venue for people to come and enjoy themselves. And it's so beautiful here, it's not hard to do. We've got another video. Whoops, let me go back to it. Right, the Mountain Dew Tour is coming to Copper Mountain this year after 11 years at Breckenridge, and so we are really, really excited about it. The team at Breck really set a high bar for us. I'm already getting sick of the Pepsi people telling me, well, this is how Breck did it. Well, Breck did this for us, and Breck did this for us. So, you know, thanks a lot, John, and, you know, but... This is important to Copper. We're really glad to keep it in the county. It's a fun event. It's an important event. It's a great venue for us, and we're glad to take the baton and run with it. So it's exciting. It's also in line with what Copper's all about, and that's that, you know, we are a training venue. We are a progression venue for beginner athletes, also elite athletes. We are the official home of the U.S. Ski and Snowboard team. They start showing up here October 25th, and they start training for the World Cup events, and this is the first place that gets open for them for both speed and tech venues. So we've built actually a new tech venue for training, and you may have heard of one of the U.S. athletes, Michaela Schifrin. A lot of what we built is in mind for her, so we're going to help put her on a podium this year. Woodward is something that most everybody in this room is familiar with. Our Woodward barn, our Woodward terrain features that we have on the park, on our parks on the mountain. We're going even further with Woodward than we ever have in the past. We've added some new venues.
What's up? I'm Red Gerard. We're here at Woodward Copper. It's sunny out, slushy, riding with the campers. Woodward always does an amazing job of putting on the funnest summer camp, I think. Not to mention one of the best summer parks, you know, in North America. So I'm happy to be here. I reached out to Gunny and asked him, and I was just trying to like hit one more good jump before summer. I knew Colorado had an amazing snow year. I figured this is the only place they could probably build a jump this big. 2 weeks later, this thing was here, so psyched.
Thank you.
is so incredibly awesome seeing that. Another thing that's important to us here at Copper Mountain is a Play Forever campaign. So this is something that's powder-wide. Play Forever is our sustainability initiative, and it's something we feel strongly about. We've dedicated resources to it, funding, and really it's important for us not only for members of the Summit County community, members of the Copper employee community, to make sure that we are advocates for our environment, but for all of the visitors that come up from the Denver metro area or come from destinations all over this country and this world, that we show them just exactly how we protect our environment here and what the minimum expectations should be for them when they go home. Just want to remind everybody before I step off the stage that we begin our snowmaking in 4 days. It's right around the corner, and we're open to public November 8th. Thank you.
Got it. Thank you, Dustin. Much appreciated. What do you think? Dustin and his family fit in the county okay? Glad to have him aboard. The mic drop was not intended. More to come. Copper has been really positioning itself as a platform for performance skiing and boarding for several years now, focusing on their high elevation, early season camps and late season camps, and now through much pretty of the year. Woodward is now in a number of locations, and they really put skiing and Summit County on the map in so doing. I'm glad to see them continuing to do that, and I'm $100 million worth of improvements with the word new on 15 slides in a row. Is a pretty impressive start. Next up, Alan Henseroth, known to all of us, I think, in his relationship with A-Basin, as it is known to everybody both here and in the state of Colorado. Ladies and gentlemen, join me in welcoming Alan Henseroth.
All right. Following those guys, following Dustin in particular. It's always great to come out to this event. I enjoy it. And where's Judy? Wherever Judy is.
Working.
Well, we're going to miss Judy. She's done a tremendous job. Thanks to the chamber and all the work she's done. It's been absolutely fantastic. And and Dustin, welcome to Summit County. I can't wait to get out there and ride Tucker Lift. And senior, that name just might stick. I heard this rumor you're going to run Keystone too, so I'm looking forward to your update on that. And also, Rob, it's only colder at A-Basin in October. The rest of the year, it's the banana belt compared to Loveland. So, you know, we really had a great season last year. I just can't say enough good things about it. Not a whole lot new to report for us, so thank you guys very much for coming today.
As Judy LaPont said at the start, wait. Alan, you can talk about nothing for another 13 minutes, but I know there's more up your sleeve. Come on. What do you got? Nothing else? Ladies and gentlemen. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, just kidding. We have a lot to talk about. So, you know, I've got five things I want to talk about for this coming season. And one of them really is last season in many years and moving forward. But we opened our Beavers expansion last year. It was just absolutely unbelievable. You know, there's a couple of great, very dark blue trails out there that people really enjoyed. And there's great glade skiing, and we've added two more trails in the glades, Todd's Ridge and Tinker Toy. And the trail crew spent much of the summer buffing out all the other trails, so I think you're just going to love what's coming next. Steep Gullies also was a blast. I don't think there's anything quite like that anywhere. It is, as it says, it's incredibly steep. It's just a stunning place to be, like none others. You feel like you're in a ski movie every time you're out there. It's so incredible. And we also opened a great little restaurant on the summit, Il Refugio. And, you know, serving all kinds of great mountain fare, delicious food, wine, beer. It's a cool place. It's a small place, so sometimes it's hard to get a seat in there. But it really fits in well with our culture and what we're trying to be, which is something a bit different from everybody else. I couldn't let the talk go on without mentioning that event last March. I mean, that was truly extraordinary for us, the snowfall. We were closed for two full days, and it wasn't really about the ski area why we were closed. You just couldn't get to the basin. I mean, the CDOT was just as busy as they could possibly be. The same time there was that avalanche on the highway just over from Copper here, and there were very few people to help us, and we had a very small crew up there, and our snow safety team was really working hard and diligently and helping CDOT work to get the highway open, and we were just about done, we thought, with all the avalanche work, and we had not seen a really big slide along the highway, although we expected to, and literally on the last shot the guys threw, this gigantic slide happened, buried the highway with about 30 feet of snow. And those of us that were up there were like, how are we gonna get out of here? But, you know, eventually we had a crew that worked with us, some CDOT people, and, you know, by the next morning at 9:15, we did get open. But that was really an extraordinary event. I think it should remind us all, you know, we have this great, very comfortable life in Summit County, but we are in some big mountains, and at times, you know, we learn a lesson or two, and that was a good one for us. And it just kept snowing. Like Joel said, it just went up and up. And by the way, Joel, I think you're a solid 65%. I look at the forecast 10 times a day. Joel's is the first forecast I go to, and especially in that 12 to 24 hour range. I think you're awesome. you know, it just kept snowing and snowing and snowing, and we stayed open till the 4th of July. And the 4th of July was actually the busiest day we've ever had at the basin. And yeah, that was my thought too. About 8 o'clock in the morning, when all the parking lots were just about full, I remember just looking around and looking at all the lines everywhere and just kind of going, oh, well, we'll see what happens. And it was truly fun, and it capped off an extraordinary season. Not only the good snowfall, not only the Beavers, Il Refugio. You know, from a business perspective, we had the best year we've ever had on literally every metric you could use. And this was the sixth year in a row we'd had something like that. We have just really been on a roll, really been on fire. And we really took a hard look at where we were and what we were doing. And on so many levels, it was like, geez, things are perfect. Don't change a thing. But I think you guys know our parking issues have been growing over the years. And they've just reached a point that is just no longer acceptable to us. And we really had to take control. And, you know, regularly some guy will come up to me in a really smug way and tell me that we need to build another parking lot. And Thank you. Appreciate it. You know, we don't have room to build another parking lot. You know, we're in a narrow, tight mountain valley. There's no more room to build parking lots. Maybe someday it'll make sense to go vertical with parking. It doesn't right now. But we had to really figure out what we were doing. We really had to take control of our business. And we've had a great 22-year relationship with Vail Resorts, and it's been good for us, it's been good for them, but we had to move on. We had to do something different with the way we were doing things. And we're probably the only ski area ever that has said our biggest goal for this next season is to do 100,000 less skiers. And it is so weird. And it is so crazy, but we just had to do something different. And if we were going to move forward, we had to change. And we were really focused on our guests, you know. And many times I've said to you, to run our business, we have five keys to our success. And one is to have a good, solid, profitable business. One is to be a great employer where our employees feel valued and appreciated. One is to deliver great guest services. And one is to be a community leader. One is to be a leader in sustainability. And if we were going to do this, we really had to focus on what the guest was encountering. So we had to change. And we liked the idea of a partner. We liked the idea with Icon that we could be a restricted partner. There are just a couple passes at this time. And, you know, the Icon pass is 7 days. The Icon base is 5 days with 10 restricted days. And we really felt that with all our modeling, and we did hours and hours and weeks of modeling and spreadsheets and trying to figure out where we were going to go. And we really liked this path. So we are excited to be moving forward. You know, I think John is one of the greatest guys in the ski business. We've worked closely together for years. None of this was personal. This was just about where we were going to take our business and how we're going to move it forward. So we're really excited about it. It was a challenging time because, you know, it took 6 months to work this all out. And I think people wanted answers now, and it just wasn't going to happen that way. So I'm so glad we're moving forward. And I think what we're going to deliver, what you're going to find at A-Basin, is going to be an experience in the coming years like none you've found anywhere else. So we've been chatting about summertime for years, and we've been dipping our toes into it. We have a very successful summer wedding business. I know Ralph at this event has bugged me a few times about what we're doing in the summertime. We're finally making the big leap, and next summer we're going to be open 7 days a week for summer operations. We're in the midst of building an aerial adventure park, which is going to be just above the base area. Beautiful place in the woods to play on platforms and climbs. It's a great place to go with your friends, your family. If you've never done something like this, you got to come out and try it. We're also going to take people up high, and we're installing a Via Ferrata, which gives people an opportunity to climb, get out on rocks, and we're going to build this Via Ferrata piece up the east wall. It's also under construction right now. It is going to be a very cool thing. In the video, you saw a portion of the Via Ferrata course, and it's really fun. We've also started building mountain bike trails and hiking trails, and over the next couple years, we're going to have a great option of places to go cross-country riding with some courses designed for downhill riding, but we're not getting into the lift surf business, at least just yet. We're going to give this a try, and lots of other fun stuff with the Sixth Alley going, disc golf, Arapaho sports, all kinds of good stuff in the summer. And, you know, I couldn't get up here in front of all this group of people without talking about sustainability. It is so important to us. Last year, I shared the core of our sustainability plan, which is 7 goals, the centerpiece of which is to be carbon neutral by 2025. That is a crazy aggressive goal, but we're committed to doing that. That includes having 100% of our electricity come from renewable sources. And we want no net increase in our water consumption, and we're doing some other things. So we're very committed to this. And I showed you this slide last year. It was a similar thing, but this is our energy usage. And I think there on the center right part of this page is the key bullet in this slide. And last year when I was here, 44% of our electricity was coming from renewable sources. This year it's 54. And I look forward in the coming years to sharing this with you and seeing that bump up and bump up and bump up. And we're gaining by doing some on-site renewable solar work. But Xcel is really helping us. Xcel is an extraordinary provider on the renewable energy front. And they have some great goals and objectives also. And, I think whenever you bump into someone from Xcel, make sure you thank them. Because they're leading the country on this. And I took part in a climate change event in Washington, D.C. back in May. And everyone I met that we were on the discussion of our utility providers, when I mentioned we were with Xcel, they all knew about Xcel and what Xcel's doing on the renewable front. So we're very proud to be a part of that, as you guys should all be too. And then lastly, there's a group working called Safe Passages. And I just wanted to share this with you. I think it's something we all need to be aware of. It's comprised of people from CDOT and the Forest Service and Colorado Parks and Wildlife and the ski areas, Summit County and several other stakeholders. And they're working on a plan to build more structures along I-70 between Copper Mountain and Vail Pass with the spirit of a big reduction in wildlife and vehicle collisions, just like they've done out on Highway 9 North. And so this is called SummitCountySafePassages.org. Take a minute, go look at that, and I think you're going to be hearing about that more and more and more as this group tries to develop a plan to get there. Okay, so this is the number five, the most important thing we have coming for you this year. So in the A-frame bathrooms, you might notice we had a little odor problem develop last year. And we gutted the place. And we ripped out all the plumbing, ripped out all the vent pipes. We found a couple of problems. And we are putting in all new fixtures, low-flow sinks and faucets. We're putting those extremely low flow urinals, the kind that like flush once a day, and that's going to be good. That's going to be good. The bad stuff goes away. But you know, if you've been around on a busy day, at least the guys in there, all those urinals are just flushing once a minute all day long. So that's going to be a huge savings in water for our goals. So we couldn't be more excited. Yesterday, our team, our leadership team, our management team did their annual fall leaders workshop, and I can tell you the energy and the passion in that group was so incredible. And we are excited for a great year, and we're already made snow once this year, and we're just waiting for it to get a little bit colder, and we're going to get open for you just as soon as we can, and I can't wait for this great season to happen. Thank you.
Things have changed some. At the top of the conversation, I talked to you about really looking differently at Summit County, not just a tourism destination, but tourism as a fuel for a year-round economy that we can all enjoy, taking the pressure off the peaks of the year and working to fill the valleys on a year-round basis. What A-Basin is doing is a perfect case study of that, right? Working on advancing their craft in the winter season with expanding to things that are really of interest to us, but really double working on how they're going to be building summer to take the pressure off winter, to build up summer. And when you go for 100,000 fewer skiers in the winter, that's not just talking the talk. That's walking the walk. So I can see them taking the pressure off the winter season, providing more diversity, bringing summer along. A good lesson for all of us as we mature to a year-round destination supported by, but not completely dominated by tourism.
locals have a role to play in sustaining the valley for all of us. My preaching is over. Next up, Rob Goodell, who will be introduced by a video and then tell you the Loveland story.
To today's highway closures. If you were so lucky to make it to the Loveland ski area, you pretty much had the place to yourself. The lines were almost non-existent.
So I thought it'd be fun today to share a passion of mine with you.
Oh, man.
We are going to go snowboarding.
No way.
You ready?
I'm so ready. How the f*** would Tayshia know if I'm ready or not?
Have you ever snowboarded before?
Not once.
All right, well, you're going to learn today.
Dude, I better get a f***ing nose because I will call that stupid bitch out. Whoa!
Okay. No.
There's only so much you can say when someone legit pulls a lie out of their ass. Like, where the f*** did that come from?
Nope, you're good, you're good. Look at that. See?
Oh, this is fun.
Yeah, there you go. We're making progress.
I'm the only one that's falling in love with Colton. So f*** her.
Good morning again, and thank you once again for having us here. Dustin, appreciate the you hosting, and your crew did a phenomenal job. Play your cards right, you can get a new shirt every year. I'll fill you in on that. John, we've been talking about bathrooms for years. Alan finally got the memo. Alan, I appreciate your fortitude in making hard decisions. I think it says a lot. He did mention about how people come up and make comments all the time. He talked about parking. This summer, they were telling us that there will be a Loveland Arapahoe Pass. I thought it was okay as long as they called it the Loveland Pass. No, it didn't happen, but congratulations. Yes, we hosted the Bachelor at Loveland. No, you can't walk from the top of Loveland Pass and then pick up snowboards and start snowboarding down. But the backstory, he abandoned her. He left her on the hill. And took off snowboarding. We had to give her a snowmobile ride back up. That's why she was swearing so much. They didn't end up together. The moral to the story, as any ski and ride school employee will tell you, always take a lesson from a professional. So over the years, Ralph has, as he did today, does a wonderful presentation, and he includes Loveland and throws us in sometimes as if we were a part of Summit County. So we are actually in Clear Creek County, but just for today, I have taken my Sharpie and included. And I see Thomas Davidson grinning. He's going to send me a tax bill. So around Labor Day, the Summit Daily News did a wonderful article about where we're all going to buy passes this season. And they did a survey, which you might think we didn't fare well. But quite honestly, I'm fine with that. Because that leads to days like this and this. As I don't have anything to talk about. So I'm going to show some pictures of friends. This shows you that people at Summit County do ski at Loveland. But I'm going to say today that we really are going to stress that we have made no changes, that we're keeping Loveland as pure as possible. This is Chet's Dream was a hit for us last year, so that's old news, that's gone by. Talking about customers and make comments, actually had a gentleman come up and complain that he could not drink his beer on the ride up. It was too fast. I'm sure you talk to any of us, we'll give you all sorts of those type stories. But we're not changing anything. We're still going to have free parking, free Ridgecat rides. In fact, Joel, the tip for taking your child, go down to Loveland Valley, go to the ticket office. 5 and under are free, but that's common everywhere. Tell them you know Rob, they'll get you a ticket. Don't tell them you're from Summit County. But then just to the east is a 70-foot-long magic carpet that she can ride all day. And as long as you don't have your equipment on, you can walk next to it, you can stand at the top, be at the bottom, and that child can ride all day at no cost, free. But don't tell anybody. We are proud to still be members of the Powder Alliance. And through our partnerships with other ski areas, we offer over 100 extra days at 30 additional resorts. And I guess we do have something new to talk about. We are partnering with CDOT for Bustang, Snowstang service. We have 40 dates throughout the season on weekends and holidays, providing transportation to and from the Front Range at a very reasonable cost. So we're hoping we can grow that program. People ask us our view on the ski industry as it stands today. It's hard to come up with a good analogy with what's going on. But thank you all. Please bring your tickets and come give us a try at Loveland.
Good one. We talked about it very well.
So there's that. Just trying to figure out why that bachelor guy left the bachelorette up on the hill. Anybody have a hint? Seems pretty self-evident to me. Loveland's has always worked for me. I'm kind of glad that it's staying the way that it is, along with many other day resorts that are providing a quality skiing experience that not all of us can keep forward. But moving on, our last presenter and his twin is John. He's following the, tell us something a little bit personal about you. That's why we got Rob Schertz involved in the overall drill, and I learned in passing that Dr. Pepper is a regular for John, so he earns that easily on. So representing big guns is John Bueller Sr. and John Bueller Jr. I don't know which one goes with which destination, so I'll leave it up to you for that, John. But the big guns, I think, in this case are both literally true as the anchor destinations in Summit County. But also there's exciting news about increased snowmaking that does more to add to the shoulder seasons that are available, and something I'm looking forward to hearing about. Do you have a video to go?
No, let's talk.
Let's go.
Good morning. I don't know which video, which photo that was, junior or senior, but if it was junior, he's not looking very good.
I love this time of year, fall, the weather's crisp in the morning, it's nice in the afternoon, and it just brings that energy back for winter, right? Everybody is excited about it, so it's a great time of year. There's a lot of COO comedians. I've just learned, yeah. It's gonna be a tough competition. So first and foremost, I wanna start and say I'm really humbled and honored to be able to speak on behalf of Keystone today. I think many of you may know, but Jeff Buckheiser, who's been the leader for the last couple years at Keystone, who's done a tremendous job with the Keystone team, is leaving to take on another assignment for our company. He is going to be the Vice President, Chief Operating Officer for Whistler Blackcomb. So that's a big achievement for him. We're incredibly proud, and he has left Keystone in great shape, and he has an amazing team that has put us on a great road to the future. I'm sure many of you are wondering who's going to run Keystone. Not John Bueller. Been there, done that, and I loved it. What I would say is that there should be an announcement very, very soon. That's about all I can say there. So let's get this presentation going. So Keystone has been working for many years to become exactly what they are today, which is based on Ski Magazine, the family-friendly resort for 2019. Unbelievable stat. And the reason they're so proud of this is because of all the effort they've done over the last several years. Kids Ski Free, Kidtopia, tubing, the snow fort, all the activation all year long, summer and winter, surrounding families. And kudos, congratulations to all of you. Pretty amazing. 18-19, we've all talked about it. What a great snow year. I'm sure every single one of you got to experience powder, but it was absolutely incredible. You know, some of the things that this team is really proud about is our net promoter score at Keystone. It was the highest it's ever been. And they think they have some really sound reasons for achieving that, and they're really proud.
The reason, one of those, is that they've taken all 2,500 employees and put them through a guest service program that they developed over the last year. And I think it made a huge difference and really shows what you can do to create an experience of a lifetime if you bring everyone together and work to pull on the same rope at the same time. Next, when you look at the snow, more snow, this was one of their biggest years. They actually opened 2 days early. And as Joel mentioned, the snow just kept coming, which allowed them to open the North Peak just 2 days after opening the front side of Durkin Mountain. And it just kept opening up more terrain, more and more, sooner and sooner. And it was fantastic. As a matter of fact, in the month of March, they received almost 90 inches of snow, just shy of 8 feet. So when I was there, and I think I was junior at that time, I think it was 12, was not a great season. Yes? Was not a great snow year in 12. We had 96 inches of snow for the entire season on Durkin Mountain. So to receive 90 inches for 1 month is pretty incredible. And then also parking. Alan, go vertical, man. Just do it. Just do it. It'll allow you to get that $100,000 back. I've lost my train of thought. No, so we went out with interstate parking to help us really increase the flow of traffic. So instead of going into a parking lot and paying at a booth, you actually got to go right in and park and then use your phone or app to pay for the day. Makes it much easier. And so this year again, they'll be doing the same thing to allow that easy access to the paid parking lots. And for 1920, the Montezuma River Run lots will still be free this next winter. So looking back, I said we opened early. I am going to talk about surface lifts. Is that okay?
Okay.
Keystone actually this last year had the ability to open more learning teaching terrain at the River Run Gondola Mid Station and added a carpet, which was absolutely a home run for all of our guests. There was a new concept at the Mountain House where the F&B team absolutely reimagined an old restaurant and remodeled it to go Big Burger. That concept went really well. Specialty burgers, fries, milkshakes. It's right at the base of the Peru Lift and was a huge, huge success. This one, I think, you know, especially on a year where there's that much snow, this was amazing. The Keystone Neighborhood Company, after years of working towards this goal, absolutely had the opportunity to snow melt the entire plaza at River Run Village. So for the guests that were staying there, those that were coming in from the parking lots, had one heck of a beautiful experience and made it so much easier on everybody. It's nice not to hear snow cats going through the plaza early morning. So I think, you know, with that, I'd like to talk a little bit about summer. Summer, it's our second year there of Stars and Guitars, which is the 4th of July celebration there. Tons of activation, again, for all the kids. New dining options at the Edgewater, which is down at the Lakeside Village, as well as Stew Bay up on the mountain. At the Conference Center, which is the largest conference center in the Colorado Rockies, put in new carpet and put in a really nice, beautiful coffee shop right in the middle for all of the guests that are utilizing those facilities. So that was really awesome as well. And then we have new Kidtopia programming daily, which is always a hit, and everybody loves being a part of those activities. So what's new for this winter? I think one of the things that we really want to talk about and the amount of time and effort is between Keystone and Breckenridge are looking to have one of the longest ski seasons in Summit County and probably one of the longest ski seasons in the country. So we invested a ton of money this year into upgrading the snowmaking system on Durkin Mountain to allow us to start firing our guns up in the next week or so and be ready to open. The new guns are really amazing. We have automated fan guns with weather sensors. So in the past, you have to go and turn on each one of the machines. This is automatically, it's computerized,
and you can set the temperature and say, hey, we want this gun to come on at a wet bulb of 27 degrees. It automatically comes on. No one has to be standing there and getting the air and water set to go. So that is so fast. Instead of it taking 3 or 4 hours to energize and charge a system and then guys walking down the hill to turn the guns on and off, instantly there's snow. And if that weather pattern only lasts for 2 or 3 hours, and it says we want to turn that off at 28 degrees, it automatically does that. So the snow quality is going to be fantastic out of these guns, allow us to be super efficient, less energy, use less water to get the same amount of snow out there. So really, really proud of that team, giving us a really early season start. Also, Alan, it was a great partnership for 22 years, and we are really excited for you moving forward and appreciate all of your support over the years. You are welcome, sir. We're big fans of that man right over there. So with that said, we also plan on being open to Memorial at Breckenridge, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. What's ahead for this winter? Obviously, our Epic Pass program is still alive and well. Epic, Epic Local, Military Pass, the Summit Value Pass, all of those are still in play. And then this year, again, the price of lift tickets has really gone up over the years, and there's a lot of great reasons for that. But what we continue to try and do at Vail Resorts is to try and give options to our guests. And this year, with the introduction of the Epic Day Pass, there are a lot of people who come up here who only want to ski for 2, 3, 4 days versus having an entire season pass. So if you purchase during our pass window, which is still open and stays open into November and sometimes December, you can purchase a day ticket for up to 50% off the existing pass. So, the existing lift ticket price of a day ticket. So that is an incredible change for us, an incredible opportunity. So those of you that have lodging properties, please share that with your guests. It's a great opportunity. The Keystone Plus Pass is another one that we feel really great about, which is the opportunity for people to have a season-long pass just for Keystone with limited restrictions, as well as starting on April 1st, our guests will also be able to ski Breckenridge through the end of the season, which is Memorial, weather dependent. And then they also get 5 days of skiing at Crested Butte. So that's a terrific pass. And then the Crested Butte and Keystone 4-pack, that is one where it's limited on holidays, but you can pick 4 days at any one of those resorts and get to experience both of them. So again, really, really incredible opportunities from a pass perspective for our guests. Kick off the early season. This is our first time entering into the race to open first, and I think this is good for everybody, right? Earlier the opening, the more traffic coming through for all of us to for our guests. So this season, this will be new and ongoing every single year with these new activations. There'll be a Halloween party. There'll be music, live music at the River Run Village. And this will go throughout October and into December up to Thanksgiving. So a lot of fun to be had for all guests, kids and adults, and we're pretty excited about that. Also coming to the village, River Run Village, is a new Mexican restaurant called Lime. And then at the Lakeside Village, we're also adding a new pizza restaurant as well. So a lot of great things ahead for Keystone. The last thing I want to talk about is something that's, we need this, right? We need more housing in Summit County, and we're proud to partner with Gorman on this project, as well as the county, where we are creating new workforce housing. We will have 144 beds, 3 units for our seasonal employees, and then there is housing that is meant for those that are inside the PUD. And then if there's still units available, then anyone within Summit County and beyond can apply to rent these units at a very low cost. So this is amazing. I actually got to tour this property 3 days ago. The views are spectacular. The parking is amazing. There's a new on-ramp from CDOT off of Highway 6 to get into this property. There's a dog park. It's pretty spectacular. And this is a great collaboration and something that we need to continue to work on as a community is to come up with more housing. So with that, I thank you from Keystone. Let's go ahead and...
Would you like me to introduce you again?
Would you?
Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to reintroduce John Bowles, Bueller, who may be the senior. We're still waiting to see how that plays out. Now speaking to you from his perspective on top of Breckenridge. Shall we run the video, John?
Please run the video. You know, sitting here today, you can't help but think what a special place we live in. And to have four, Thomas, if you allow it, five amazing resorts to ski at in this county. It's incredible. And I think, you know, we heard earlier from Ralph that no one skis more visitors than us, except for California. And that's just our county, which is absolutely incredible. So... congratulations, and appreciate you all living here and supporting all of us and what we do here every day. So, looking at a record-breaking season, more than 460 inches of snow. It was the second largest ski season we've ever had. And to just put that in perspective, because it sounds like a lot, right? That's 38 feet of snow. That is a lot of snow. It was our earliest open. We opened 2 days early as well, just like Keystone. And we opened every single peak earlier than we ever had before. The Imperial Chair has never opened for Thanksgiving. It was open for Thanksgiving. We usually don't open peak six until like the 19th or 20th of December. That was opened like December 1st. Absolutely incredible, incredible start. And the momentum just continued to carry on. Snowiest month of March, if you want to know what that equals, everybody know? In feet? Not over 9 feet, right? Almost 10 feet, 9 foot six, something like that, 9 foot five. So again, unbelievable. And for the first time, this gave us that opportunity to go ahead and extend. And so we told our team in February, hey, let's take a look at extending into Memorial Weekend. And then we were having so much fun. We just couldn't let Alan have it all. So we said, let's do it. Let's go into June. And we got to ski all the way until June 9th this year. Moving forward, we will continue to be skiing into Memorial as long as snow conditions permit. So we are creating that, like I said, really, really extended season. What that did, though, and I think Ralph also spoke to that, that challenged getting things open for summer. We actually had 5 days between winter and summer to get things opened up. And all I can say is our teams did an amazing job to actually produce both in that short a time. So they were scrambling, they were scratching their heads how they were gonna get it done, and they did it, they got it done. So I'm really proud of them. Breck Mountain cleanup, most resorts have this, where, you know, people eat on the chairs and you know, there's trash on the ground. I think these are pretty amazing stats, but what I really love is how we are all talking about sustainability. And one of the ways we're really working on this is instead of using trash bags anymore, we're using lodgings and hospitalities, old used pillowcases to pick up the trash with. And so I think we're really helping out the environment there. But 300 pounds of trash, 100 pounds of recyclable, and then we also plant trees every year that we receive these saplings from the Forest Service. So we're very thankful to them for supplying those to us. And then, you know, when Rob comes up here, I'm also going to talk about bathrooms, Alan, Rob. But when we come up here and joke around or say, you know what, this year we don't have that much to talk about, there is so much going on at a resort to try and bring it back to life after a long season. And for us, we are continuing to really strive to improve our snowmaking system. And over the last 2 years, we've put in 110 low-energy, high-efficiency guns to help reduce our electrical footprint and our carbon footprint. So we're really pleased with that. What else? We're also, you know, the chairlifts, they take a lot of work. We just replaced the T-bar haul rope, and we are replacing the gondola haul rope in the next couple weeks. That is a massive undertaking, and looking forward to getting that one done. Looking ahead to this winter, all right, this is game-changing. This is transformational. For the last 10 years, we've been walking through this narrow corridor as you come off the gondola onto the snow on Peak 8. We now have a brand new base facility that you're seeing right here. It has an ice rink. That ice rink is actually going to open up on December 13th, we hope, which is absolutely amazing. This opens up how you get onto the snow. Will be incredible. But what it really does, and one of the things that's really cool about this is Breck is built in a way that you have to climb stairs. Not anymore. We have escalators. I'll just pause for a moment. Escalators. Pretty incredible. I think it's the only, Beaver Creek and Breckenridge are the only escalators in the country, and we now have them in Summit County. So beyond escalators, what we have is a brand new bus drop-off, snow melted. We have brand new parking for guests, you know, 5-minute parking and for drop-off, and there are 21 spots up there for that. We also have a new ski school facility, a new childcare facility, a new retail rental shop, a new ski school ticket office, product sales offices for tickets and season passes. There's a new coffee shop, and there are new bathrooms, more bathrooms for Breckenridge at Peak 8. So ours didn't smell, we just didn't have any. So we now do have quite a few more. So anyway, this is absolutely amazing, and this doesn't happen without the partnership of Breck Grand Vacations. They're also gonna have 71 units available for our guests starting in late November, early December. So really excited about that, and the remainder of those units will open up in the spring. So thank you to Grand Vacations and their partnership and leadership on that project. It is absolutely game-changing. This is what it looks like. I kept the there's still the trailers, which used to be our ticket offices, but you can see how wide it opens up in comparison to what it's been in the past. Absolutely amazing. And on the right, you're kind of looking into the ticket office area. So pretty spectacular. And again, another area of transformation for us is on Peak 9. We have a brand new, it used to be called the Village Hotel, and now it's called the Gravity House. It's a really neat change in ownership. We will be managing the contract on that, but this team is really talking about blowing this out and having the Gravity House and Social Club. They have trampolines on site, 60 new rooms. Sleeping accommodations are uniquely different. They have on-site fitness centers. It's just going to be a complete game changer for Peak 9. Also on Peak 9, the 10-mile conference room collapsed, I think, 4 or 5 years ago. We are now in the midst of rebuilding that, and we will have that up in the next year. So pretty excited to have that as well on Peak 9. So things are moving at Breck. Dustin, if you need to talk to me about the Dew Tour, please go ahead. But no, really, we had a wonderful 11-year run with the Dew Tour. We're pleased to have it stay in Summit County. You know, it's always time and great to have a change every now and then. So thank you for taking that on. And then there's been these rumors that, oh my gosh, Breck is no longer going to have terrain parks. We are a world-class operation when it comes to terrain parks, as you can tell by the Dew Tour. We will have our terrain parks, our terrain park progression. We have two terrain parks on Peak 9, one on Peak 8, and we're going to have a half pipe again. And this year, though, we're changing it to an 18-foot half pipe because we believe that's what most people can actually ride that aren't professionals. So we feel really good about going to an 18-footer. Along with that, we're also going to bring back Snow Dance. We're working with the town right now on permitting and getting through that process, but that was an all-encompassing mountain and town event to kick off the season. We were really excited to do that, and we're really excited to bring it back. So parking, go vertical. In conjunction with the town, we're really excited that we are going to have a parking structure on South Gondola Lot. That is going to start in earnest May of this year. So May 2020, we'll be putting shovels in the ground, and we'll be without the South Gondola parking lot for a year. And when it gets back, we'll have 400 new spots, along with the 600 that were already on there. So pretty excited. In terms of the future, we're working with the Forest Service on this right now, but we're also looking at how do we continue to make a difference with our capital investments at Breckenridge. And this is one way that we think we can do that, is by adding a lift on Peak 7. Because we need to ease the congestion at the base of Peak 7. That lift, we thought when we put it in originally, a six-pack would do us just fine. That's not the case. We're busy, and we need it. And so this allows you to get from, instead of going from peaks out to Peak 6 and coming all the way back and getting into that line at the Independence Chair, you're going to be able to load this chair just below the Zendo Chair, get up to Pioneer Crossing, and be able to spread out from there. So it's going to give you access to Peaks 6, 7, and 8. It's going to allow you to explore some of the untapped terrain that's on Peak 7. There's quite a few trails that just don't get utilized. This will fly right over that, and we expect that this is going to help ease congestion on other trails as well. So really excited about that opportunity. And then, again, as everybody has talked about, and I think you guys should all be very proud that in our community, we consider and care so much about it that sustainability is one of the biggest things that we can do here. And so for us, Epic Promise is our arm for that. Communities, mountain, and our future. And we have, three wings of it. The foundation is our support mechanism for our employees. And these are the numbers for Keystone and Breckenridge, where we've given relief grants of $96,000, almost $100,000 to employees. We also have given education grants to our employees and their family members of up to $42,000. And then the community, our volunteer efforts, we really encourage and engage our employees to get involved. We also have a program where an employee can actually get paid for a week's worth of salary to go and volunteer at any organization of their choice. And we think that's just a great way to give back. So this just, was it last weekend or 2 weekends ago, we just volunteered at the high school, the Keystone Science School, and with the BOEC. And our volunteer hours on that, we had 250 volunteers and just had an amazing experience out there, and we definitely completed more than they thought. If you've ever painted, how many of you have been in the high school locker or high school before? Those rows of lockers, those hallways are long. We painted every single one of those hallways. Yeah, we got some on the floor. I heard about it from my wife. That's okay. I'm still here. So when it comes to the sustainability, we have three areas of focus: zero net emissions by 2030, zero waste to landfill by 2030, and zero net operating impact to the forest and habitats. And again, our focus is huge on that. Some of the things that we've done is, again, the snowmaking technology to low energy guns, the ongoing LED conversions at our facilities at both resorts. We've gotten rid of all of our plastic or paper Pepsi cups, have gone to recyclable tumblers. We no longer have straws, so bring your own. We're participating in Xcel's Renewable Energy Connect program and engaging in the Summit County Climate Action Coalition. And then we are also really working hard in all of our restaurants, all of our facilities, to compost at every single one of those locations this year. So huge, huge work is being done. We do a progress report every year that's coming out in October, and hopefully we'll be able to share all of that with you. The last thing I want to say is, again, thank you, Dustin. It's great to have you in this community. Go Broncos. And thanks to your team for hosting amazing breakfast, as always. So kudos to you. The other two over here are just characters. That's all I can say. I love them both. And I couldn't be more proud to be a part of this community and to work with all of you in one capacity or another. So thank you very much.
Always fun. It may not be apparent to you as much as it is to me that the fraternity that you see amongst and between the colleagues here is not something that you can expect to encounter at other resorts and other resort communities. So you are blessed in ways that you may not be aware of about what feels good about how people work and live together in Summit County. I want to offer just a comment about snow brought forward by the significant investment in snow making for Keystone and Breckenridge, which will be extending a season as long as potentially 4 months, following what A-Basin and Loveland have been able to do to get Summit County in the news early on. But it's particularly germane for a couple of reasons. There's a phenom called snow equity. The snow in the last year was a great snow year, is what sticks in the destination guest's mind as they think forward about the next year. So we've already got a great start in snow equity from last year going forward to this year. There's concern, and legitimately so, about global warming, but the higher elevations are the ones that are going to be able to sustain their product the best. And when Jeff gets to Whistler and finds out that the top of Whistler, although a magnificent mountain, is lower than the bottom of any of the mountains here, when you start skiing at 2,100 feet, for goodness sakes, you know, you will find a new way to end the Summit County. So it's natural that Loveland and A-Basin have always led the charge. It's natural that snowmaking could extend the front end and the tail end of the season, which also extends the economic foundation on a year-round basis. It takes the pressure off the peaks time of the year by allowing us to get our business brought more broadly, and that keeps people employed, that gives them housing, that keeps the engine going. So all this fits together very nicely as if it were planned. I would like to figure out how to take credit, but of course, I've been on airplane mode, haven't I? So I conclude my comments. I'd like to invite Rick back here to talk about the winner of the prize, and thank you for keeping me around.
Okay, without further ado, and on behalf of Summit Orthopedics, I'd like to announce the winners of the auction. So Doug Berg is a double winner of the Cat Tour and skiing with Alan Hensroth. My partner, Dr. Zan Corville, won the A-Basin Kids Club. Mark Nunn is going to be skiing with John Bueller. And Christy Eckert has the Beaver Run Luxury Package. Thank you very much.
cat skiing and skiing with Alan. Woohoo! First of all, there was a big announcement made earlier, and I wasn't quite prepared for it. Judy, would you please stand up? Announced her retirement from the Summit Chamber. Let's give her a big round of applause. Judy started with the chamber in 2011, and there's no doubt in my mind or any of the board members or most of the people in this room that the chamber and this event would not be in the place it is without Judy. So huge hats off to her. Along with that, I'd like to have all our volunteers, meaning our chamber board members and diplomats that helped put on this event, would you please stand up? I'd like to thank Joel Grotz and Ralph. As I told you in the beginning, winter is coming. Also like to, like to thank our event manager, Angelique. She was back there. She's the one that arranged the electronic silent auction that I'm happy the way it turned out. And she just helps coordinate this event, helps our sponsors, helps all our electronics and everything happens. So thank you, Angelique. Sherry Ryan, who's our communication manager, she is the one that sends out all the publications about this event, helps you all get registered, truly transformed how the chamber operates, set up a company called Chamber Master with us, so all your payments can be done electronically. Sherry has done a lot of work. She's right back by the door. Huge effort. Thank you, Sherry. And lastly, if you are an auction winner, right outside the doors right here, there's a table set up. You can stop there and make your payment for your auction items that you won. Again, in closing, thank you very much. Winter is coming.